when I'm tossed on life's sea, and the waves they cover me, and the storm clouds won't let the sunshine through. Then a voice seems to say, child, there'll be a brighter day. Don't allow the storms to hide sleep.
Talk to you about the Valley of Baca. Baca means tears or weeping. The Valley of Tears. It's from Psalm 84. And I'm going to read this, and I'm going to explain it a little bit along the way because a little not real clear. This was a song that was sung by the chief musician. I'm going to go to verse 4. Blessed are they that dwell in thy house. They will be still praising thee. Now, that Selah, that just means a pause or a rising in voice. But anyway, let me just break this down a little easier to understand. Blessed are they that are faithful to your house, because they will always be praising you. Verse 5, blessed. Now, blessed, you want to be blessed. Blessed is the man who realizes his strength is not in himself, but it's in you. It's not me. Because his heart, and the reason he knows that is because his heart is fixed on God and his ways. Verse 6. Now, if you're blessed, you're faithful to God's house, you're praising God, you realize your strength is not you, it's him, it's not what you can do, it's what he can do, and your heart is fixed on God, then, who passing through the Valley of Baca. When you come to this valley, when you're in that valley, you realize that you're praising the Lord, you're faithful to God, you realize it's not your strength, you're in the midst of this valley, and you passing through it, you make it a well, and the rain will fill the pools, and you will go from strength to strength, You will be stronger when you come out of the valley than you were when you went in. Every one of them in Zion, God has not forgotten you. You will appear before God. He hasn't forgotten you when you're in the valley. Now, the Christian life, regardless of what some say, is not always a mountaintop experience. Sometimes there are valleys that we have to walk through. Life itself is made up of success and failure, victories and defeat, twists and turns, ups and downs. Now, all of us have had some mountaintop experiences, and we've also had some valleys that we had to walk through. I praise God for the mountaintops, those times when everything is great, it's wonderful. I mean, you feel like you could jump over a wall, run through a troop, and charge hell with a water pistol. I mean, everything is great. And the Bible is full of some marvelous, marvelous mountaintop experiences. I'm going to mention a few of them. We'll get to the valley in a minute. You won't like that part. Mount Ararat. This is Noah. He had been in that ark for 7 months. He says 150 days he'd been in that ark. Crowded conditions, smelly animals, and all of a sudden the sun breaks through. The clouds and the ark has landed on Mount Ararat. God had not, it said God remembered Noah. God had not forgotten him. And it must have been an exciting day, a moment, when they opened the door of that ark. The sky is blue, the rain is gone, and suddenly there is a rainbow that appears. God's promise, I won't do this again. I will not destroy the earth with water again. Mount Moriah. This is Abraham. God has instructed him to offer his son, Isaac, his only son, that he loved. To offer him as a sacrifice, to go to a mountain that he would show him. He goes to Mount Moriah. The altar is built. Isaac is on the altar. And Abraham takes the knife and is ready to cut his son's throat as a sacrifice. And suddenly God says, Abraham, Abraham, stop. It always fascinated me. He only said, Abraham, go one time. He had to say stop twice. And suddenly there's a ram caught in the thicket. God had provided a substitute, a perfect picture of what God would do in offering his son as a sacrifice for our sins so we could know God. Then, Mount Horeb. This is where God first spoke to Moses at the burning bush. Anytime God speaks to you, it's a mountaintop experience. Maybe you're listening to a song, listening to a sermon. Someone says something. Are you just driving down the street, minding your own business, and all at once God says, think about this. And your heart goes to pound and you get excited. God has opened up something to you. He's revealed something to you. Makes your heart pound. That's always an exciting. Anytime you've had God has spoken to you. That's a mountaintop experience. And I love this one. I probably should have left it out. Mount Hebron. You know, of 3 million Jews that came out of Egypt in bondage, only 2 of them made it into the promised land. They had 3 million funerals in the desert. 40 years, 3 million funerals in the desert. 2 of them, Joshua and Caleb. They were 2 of the spies that Moses sent to spy out the land. Now they have conquered the land. 40 years have passed. They've conquered the land, and Joshua is distributing the inheritance to the tribes. Caleb shows up. He says, Joshua, you remember when Moses sent us to spy out the land, and he promised us that he would give us the land that we spied out for an inheritance? And I went to this mountain, a mountain of giants, of renowned giants, walled cities. And Joshua, I am as strong now as I was then. I can go out and I can come in and I can make war. Now give me this mountain. Everybody needs a mountain. Listen, he said, I'm 85 years old and I'm as strong now as I was then. Don't ever think that you're too old for God to use you. There's something you can do. That's what they told me when I said I was going to start the sheep shed. You're too old. You can't do it when you're 70 years old. Well, I may not be as strong as I once was. I don't need your rocking chair. There's something you can do. I've been talking some to our older, respected generation. Call them seniors, call them golden years. I don't care what you call us. Let us do something. Don't ever think you're too old to be used of God. Let me give you one more mountaintop. Mount Transfiguration. Peter, James, and John on the mountain, they see Jesus, Moses, and Elijah transfigured in their glorified bodies. And they got so excited, they said, let's just build three tabernacles. One for Jesus, one for Moses, one for Elijah, and we'll just stay here. Jesus said, nope, go down the mountain. Because there is a man down there who has a son who's demon-possessed, and he needs to be delivered. When you're on the mountaintop, remember, there are those in the valley that need your help. Blessed are those that are faithful to God's house and who praise God. Blessed are those who realize that their strength is not in them, it's in Him, and their heart is fixed on God. Because when you are passing through the valley of tears, you will realize that you can turn your valley into a well, so those that follow you will have something to drink from. And you will go from strength to strength. You'll be stronger when you come out than you were when you went in. That's what God says. Now, we talked about some mountaintops. Let me give you some valleys. How about the valley of death? Not yours. The death of a loved one. Death of a family member dies, and the people who live in that house walk through the valley of the shadow of death. And too often we too quickly forget about those people. Oh, we're there when the death occurs, shortly after. We send flowers, we take food, we go to visitation night, we go to the funeral, and then we go home and forget it. But those people who live in that house, they go home to an empty, lonely house. Someone is missing. And they walk through the valley. And they don't need to be forgotten. What about the valley of temptation? Pastors hear about people's temptations that nobody else hears about. When you're struggling with temptation, you're walking through the valley. The thing about being a pastor, you have to go to the pulpit, whether you're on a mountaintop or walking through the valley. You still have to be there. And sometimes, pastors go to the pulpit when they're walking through the valley of tears. And you may not know it. But I know, if there are times that I stand in this pulpit, when I'm in the valley, I know there must be times you're sitting there looking at this pulpit when you're in the valley. Talking about pulpit, let me tell you about this pulpit. We had started, we were still at Granny Schaefer's. I was out on my tractor, and I passed a brush pile, and I saw this big hedge apple root that had three branches sticking up from it, growing out of this one root. Now, this had been on top of that brush pile for years, 50, 60, 80 years, maybe longer. Hedge apple does not rot. It was nasty, corroded over on the outside. And for some reason, I drug that thing out of that brush pile. Took it home, scraped all of the crud and corruption off of it, sanded it down, and called a friend of mine, Lloyd Smith. I called him, I said, Lloyd, I need a favor. I said, you built the first pulpit that I had when I came to Joplin. It's only fitting that you build the last one that I'll ever have. He came down, looked at this. I said, I want to use this as a base. And he finished it out and put the top on it. How many of you know that I have a pulpit committee that approves every sermon that I preach? Did you know that? It's called the Father, Son, and the Holy Ghost. These three legs that's holding this pulpit up, that represents to me the Father, Son, and the Holy Ghost. Well, no wonder you couldn't see it. I threw that in. Joe said we need to mention something about the pulpit. The Valley of Despair and Depression. Do you know there's more suicides on the holidays of Christmas and New Year's than there is any other time of the year? More suicide than any other time of the year. People just get depressed if they've got nothing to live for. And you realize that sometimes people come to church when they're in the valley of depression and despair. And you know, I told you we've been called to hug in church. Did you know that sometimes just a meaningful hug? Now, I'm not talking about one of them hugs where somebody just comes up and says, put their arms out and turns their head. I'm talking about a meaningful hug. That's not a hug. That's an insult. You won't get away with that with me because I'll grab you. I will grab you, and I will give you a meaningful hug. And if you turn your head, I'm going to kiss you on the cheek. If you're not careful, church, we get to thinking you're supposed to have a mountaintop experience every time you come to God's house. But whether you realize it or not, you should come to God's house not always because of you, but because there's probably somebody there that needs you to be there to give them a hug and to let them know that you care. Somebody that's just barely hanging on, walking through the valley, feel like they've got nowhere to turn, and they're just waiting for somebody to put their arm around them, hug them, and say, hey, you're important to me. I sure miss you if you weren't here. Hug is important. The valley of fear. Now, some of you may not even know what fear is. I doubt that. Everybody's had some moments of fear in their life. But there are some people that live in fear all the time. And there are times that fear can be a powerful force and have a powerful grip on your life. Some people come to church. They have something going on in their life, their family, that is fear. Valley of backsliding. You know, the very fact that you're a backslider means that you had a mountaintop experience, because anytime you've come to Jesus Christ, you've had a mountaintop experience. But there are a lot of people. Sometimes people have an experience with Christ and then something happens that makes them withdraw. Someone disappointed them, someone let them down, maybe they got overlooked. But something happened and made them withdraw. They know in their heart they're not right with God. They're in the valley of backsliding. What about the valley of a broken heart? There are a lot of people that are broken hearted and they're hurting and they sit in church every week. Every Sunday. They've gone through a divorce. They've lost a loved one. They hurt. The valley of a broken heart. And their life will never be the same. It may be better, it may be worse, but it'll never be the same. they're in the valley of a broken heart. And I know some of you are sitting there thinking, Mack, this is the first Sunday of the year I sure wanted to hear a real upbeat, positive sermon. But there's some of you sitting there saying, come on, Mack, you're walking right down my valley. Don't quit now. What about the valley of regret? The devil can whip you and beat you right down into the valley over something you have done in the past. Now, God says you're forgiven. Pastor says you're forgiven. You say you're forgiven. But you still find yourself in the valley of regret over something that you did in the past. And it just flares up out of nowhere. Something happened years ago, and all at once, bam, it hits you again. Just out of the blue, and you get in the valley again. You know you're forgiven, but it's there, and the devil beats you down. Nothing can hurt you worse than your own thoughts and your own guilt. The valley of addiction. Many people, every day of their life is a struggle because of addiction to alcohol, drugs, pornography, whatever. Some force that rules their life. Their life is built around their addiction. Their waking moments or thoughts are about how do I get to my addiction? What do I do? How do I do it? Wait till I get a chance. They walk through the valley every day of their lives. Anything that rules your life drives you into the valley. I'm going to give you one more, and then I'll close. The valley of the lost. I wonder, now this will be a little bit of a different twist, but I wonder how many people are sitting in church every Sunday who are lost. But they can't come to the altar for salvation because everybody thinks they're already saved. They've been in church so long. They've been faithful. They may have even worked in teaching classes or being an usher or being a deacon. But they sit there in their heart of hearts, knowing they have never come to Jesus Christ for salvation. Locked in because they're afraid of what someone might think. There has never been a saint who has not had to walk through some valleys. And most of the saints that you know who are strong, they walked through the valley and came out stronger than they were when they went in. They go from strength to strength. There was a poem I learned years ago, and I don't know whether I remember it or not. An old man traveling a lone highway came in the evening cold and gray to a chasm deep and wide through which was flowing a sullen tide. The old man crossed in the twilight dim, for the sullen stream held no fear for him. But he turned when he reached the other side and builded a bridge to span the tide. Old man cried, a fellow pilgrim near, you're wasting your time with building here. You've crossed the chasm deep and wide. Why build you a bridge at eventide? The builder raised his old gray head. Good friend, on the path I've come, he said, there followeth after me today a youth whose feet must pass this way. He too must cross in the twilight dim. Good friend, I'm building this bridge for him. That is what the sheep shed is all about. We're building bridge for those that will follow us. What's your valley? This is your time to say, I'm changing this. I tell you what I want you to do. As an act of your faith, I want you to come down here and I'm going to have you repeat something after me. If you've been in the valley or you are in the valley now, you come. This is an act of your faith. You're going to step out. You're going to step out as an act of your faith. Now, thank God for all of you that are not in the valley right now. Praise God. You ought to just have your hands up and be shouting and dancing up and down the aisle. Because there are a lot of people going through valleys right now. This is your moment. Move in a little closer so we can get some others in here. Wow. We're going to repeat something. You started off faithful to God's house. You've been here praising God. This is our 7th anniversary. I'd like to see another 7, wouldn't you? Sad fact is, some of us won't make another 7. But we're building a bridge for those that follow us. There have been some bridge builders already gone on. You ready? I want you to repeat after me. I've been in the valley of tears long enough. I'm going through this valley. No, say it. I'm going through this valley. I'm going to turn my valley into a well of living waters. Say it again. I'm going to turn my valley into a well of living waters. So others can drink from my well. From my well. So others can drink from my well. You're building a bridge for those that will follow you. Some of you came today, you didn't want to be here. You're in the valley. You'd have felt better just staying home watching television. But I guarantee you, you'll leave here stronger than you were when you came. Father, I release your power, your anointing on every person here. This is the end of this valley. You're just waiting on them to turn it into a spring of living water so they can have a place for others to drink who follow them. May you bless them, cause your face to shine upon them. May they walk in health, prosperity, and blessing and be faithful to you this year. And we will all agree in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen.